Good evening, everyone. Hi there. My name is Emily Underwood. I work in community engagement here at the Missouri History Museum. I am so happy to welcome you tonight, both those of you who are here in our audience. I'm so happy to see your faces, or at least half your faces, and also those of you who are joining us virtually this evening. I'm happy to have you here as well. I do want to start the evening by acknowledging that we gather today on the ancestral lands of Native peoples who were removed unjustly, and that we in this community are the beneficiaries of that removal. We honor them as we live, work, and study on these lands, and today we're gathered on the lands of the Osage Nation, the Illini Confederacy, Missouri peoples, and many other tribes who have called the area now known as St. Louis, Missouri home. I feel especially privileged that this is the first live program I've done and gotten to do the welcome for in a very long time. And I'm very happy that it's for tonight's program, which is called the Latinx Diaspora, Personal Perspectives on Heritage, Culture, and What It Means to Be Latinx, which kicks off National Hispanic Heritage Month, which officially starts today. Looking forward at our calendar, you can also join us on September 24th for our Cuentos en Español program, which is our morning storytelling program. That does take place every month, twice a month. And this particular installment on September 24th is going to celebrate the history and culture of Hispanic and Latinx people. Then you can also join us virtually on Tuesday, October 12th at 11 a.m. for A Tale of Two Territories, Missouri's Road to Statehood and Puerto Rico's Status in the U.S., which is going to feature a distinguished panel moderated by Daniela Velasquez of the Puerto Rican Society, Inc. of St. Louis. And that's going to focus on what it means to be in territorial limbo from a historical, political, and cultural point of view. So before we dive into tonight's program, I have a couple of quick things to mention. The Missouri History Museum in Forest Park is open Tuesday through Sunday. We'd love for you to come visit all of our wonderful exhibits and attend some of our programs. Please be sure to visit our website, which is mohistory.org. You can get all the up-to-date information on the exhibits and programs, as well as current COVID guidelines. And of course, all of those exhibits and programs are, and all of the work really that we do with our collections and archives wouldn't be possible without a ton of support. So I want to thank all of the Missouri Historical Society members for contributing to keeping history alive. If you're not a member yet, but you value the kind of programs that we do, we would love for you to join today or consider joining today. You can get more information about membership at mohistory.org/support. And I also want to thank everyone in St. Louis City and County for your tax contributions through the Zoo Museum Tax District. And then finally, I want to quickly mention that if you have any questions for the panelists, you can write those down on a note card. If you didn't see them on your way in, if you're here in the building, I'm happy to hand those out in just a few minutes. And if you're watching on Zoom, you can put your questions into the Q&A feature, and we'll make sure to get those to our moderator this evening. And speaking of our moderator, I'm going to go ahead and introduce you to her right now. Suzanne Sierra is the Senior Program Manager for the St. Louis Mosaic Project. In her role, she manages community programs and initiatives focused on the Mosaic Project's goal of transforming St. Louis into the fastest growing major metropolitan area for immigration by 2025. This includes collaborating with business and university leaders and community partners to provide professional and social connections to foreign-born individuals, professionals, and entrepreneurs. Suzanne's previous experience includes senior communication roles with Anheuser-Busch and Fleischmann-Hillard, where she worked on Hispanic marketing, corporate social responsibility, and crisis communication programs. Suzanne holds a BA in journalism from the University of Wisconsin and is of Colombian descent. She serves on the boards of the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce of Metropolitan St. Louis and the Collective Thread. Suzanne is a graduate of the 2021 Focus St. Louis Leadership St. Louis program. And just last week, she was recognized as St. Louis Business Journal Champion for Diversity and Inclusion. So congratulations on that honor. She also works ongoing to coach first-time entrepreneurs through the BALSA Foundation. Suzanne, we are so appreciative of your time tonight and for being here. Thank you so much. Thanks to everyone who's joining us. And please join me in giving a nice warm welcome to Suzanne.
Thank you, Emily. And thanks to everybody who's here in the audience and on Zoom. Really happy that you joined us. And thank you so much to the Missouri History Museum for hosting us tonight and for all of your support throughout the years with the Hispanic community. We really appreciate it. So Emily told you a little bit about me, and I just want to give you a little bit more background about Mosaic. The St. Louis Mosaic Project is a regional initiative of the World Trade Center of St. Louis. And what the World Trade Center does is it works with St. Louis companies that are looking to export their goods or services internationally, as well as working with St. Louis-based companies as well as working with international companies that want to get a foothold in the US. And we, of course, want them to come to St. Louis. And so in the latter scenario, if international executives come here to put a stake in the ground in St. Louis, they often bring their families. And that's where Mosaic comes in. We're part of what we call the aftercare. And so, you know, oftentimes the executives working and the family is stuck in a suburb somewhere and they don't know anyone, or they maybe know one or two people. And so that's where Mosaic comes in, to try to work with these people to help them create their sense of belonging by making warm introductions to individuals and organizations, and down the road, perhaps to career opportunities so that they can work. Because it's all about, again, making them feel like they belong here. And it's through events like this, these kinds of events that celebrate diversity. Our goal in the region, as Emily said, is to transform St. Louis into one of the fastest growing major metros for immigration by the year 2025. And so we do that by amplifying how, as a region, we are welcoming to people that are not from here, to people that don't look like us. We want them to feel welcome. At the end of the day, we want people to come to St. Louis and want to stay here and to recognize that we are diverse, and how being diverse and being from different cultures really enriches the community, and it's good for all of us. So on that note, I'm gonna introduce a video that really sets up the theme for tonight. It's a PSA called Belonging Begins With Us. And this is something that was created by a nonprofit national organization called Welcoming America, of which Mosaic is a member. And Welcoming America is comprised of nonprofits and local elected officials from around the country that all work to advance welcoming initiatives. And so this year, this Ad Council PSA debuted, and you'll see it's called Belonging Begins With Us. And with that, I will turn it over to the screen so you can see what I'm talking about.
If I could be you, you could be me for just 1 hour. If we could find a way to get inside each other's minds. If you could see you through my eyes instead of your ego, I believe you'd be surprised to see that you've been blind. Walk a mile in my shoes. Walk a mile in my shoes. Yeah, before you abuse, criticize, and accuse. Walk a mile in my shoes. Walk a mile in my shoes. Well, before you abuse, criticize, and accuse. Walk a mile in my shoes.
Okay, I wanna know tomorrow how many people were humming that the rest of the night. Every time I hear that, it sticks in my ear. I just love it. But so, you know, as you can see, I mean, belonging begins with us. It does start with every single person to understand that they have a role in helping others feel like they belong here. And so that really, you know, sets the theme. And I'll just say before I introduce our first presenter, that this is actually Welcoming Week. So again, Welcoming America launches every year an annual celebration called Welcoming Week, where cities like St. Louis really, you know, pull together, and organizations hold events that celebrate differences, that celebrate cultural diversity. And we're really proud to be a member and to have worked with organizations like the History Museum and all kinds of other partners, the YMCA, the Central and County Libraries. They all have online and in-person events during Welcoming Week, which runs through September 19th. And so with that as our backdrop and as our introduction, I am very pleased to welcome to the podium to give us some demographic information about the Hispanic community in St. Louis. J.S. Onesimo Sandoval, otherwise known as Ness, Dr. Sandoval, he is co-director of public and social policy and professor at St. Louis University. Ness.
Thank you very much. So I'm going to spend about 5 minutes briefly talking about the 2020 census and what it means for St. Louis as a city, for St. Louis County, St. Charles County, and for the greater St. Louis metropolitan region. So I want to come back and talk about the 2010 census. The 2010 census was a great census because it gave us a sense of what we should be expecting in 2020. And part of the argument that I will make is that the 2020 census is a great census because it's going to give us a perspective of what we can expect in 2030. But we already saw in 2010 some fairly important shifts that were happening in the United States. And that is the majority of the growth at the US level was coming from racial minorities. And the largest percentage of that growth was coming from Latinos. And then we saw that similar trend was happening here in the St. Louis metropolitan region, where the majority of the growth actually came from racial minorities. So if we look at the 2020 census, we now see that 100% of the population growth in the United States came from racial minorities. This was actually the first census where we saw a decline in Americans who identified as non-Hispanic whites. We see this in St. Louis now. 100% of the growth in the St. Louis metropolitan region came from racial minorities. There was actually a decline in the white population, and we actually see a small decline in the African-American population for the St. Louis metropolitan region. And so these population trends will continue to express themselves in cities such as St. Louis, in cities such as Knoxville, Memphis, Denver, Colorado. We're going to see tremendous population growth. So we look at population curves because population curves allow us to understand the rated influence of history and population momentum. So this is the population curve from starting with 1980 using the census data. And we can see that for the St. Louis metropolitan region, the population has been growing at a small exponential rate. So there's two parts of this story. One part is to be very excited. If we just look at St. Louis by itself, the population is growing and it's growing exponentially. The second part of this is there should be some caution, because when we start to compare St. Louis to other major metropolitan regions, we should be a little concerned because we're not growing as fast as some other regions. We are the 21st largest metropolitan region in the United States, yet in terms of absolute numbers, St. Louis ranks about 82. We have the 82nd largest Latino population in the United States. So there's something happening. There's a disconnect between the size of our region and the absolute size of the Latino population. If we start to compare ourselves to other cities such as Memphis that are much smaller than St. Louis, they actually have a larger Latino population. So we want to kind of pause and saying, if the St. Louis metropolitan region is going to grow, it needs to increase its Latino population. So we have about 106,000 Latinos in the metropolitan region. If we continue to grow the way we grew in the past 10 years, we'll be about 180,000 in 2030. I would make the argument that that's not enough. If St. Louis wants to stay at 21, or even if it wants to be back in the top 20, it's going to need at least 250,000-300,000 Latinos living in the city. Right, so this and it can happen. It could be, because we know that if you saw that previous chart, the majority of that growth is coming from Latinos. And so we know that there's really two big, there's more than two, but there's some major population growth coming from the South. One out of Texas and one out of California. They're not all gonna live in California and Texas. They're gonna move to secondary cities. The question for St. Louis is, what are we gonna do? Are we gonna go to Houston, Texas? And are we going to promote St. Louis as a place to live to the 3 million Latinos who are going to be born in Houston, in Texas, right? What are we being proactive and actually going there and saying move to St. Louis? So that's a question for us to see if our labor is going to have fruit in 2030. So we saw an increase of 34,500 Latino residents. And so we are able to break this down by age, and this just kind of shows you about 70% of that increase came from Latinos over the age of 18. So this is a little bit different, right? Because for those who have seen my previous presentation, the largest component of the Latino population is is 0 to 4 and 5 to 9 years old. So we're growing, but the component of our population of our growth is very different compared to Houston, Dallas, Miami, where that growth is coming from population under 18. Also, if we look at the counties that experienced that growth, St. Louis County experienced the largest part of that growth at 35%. 17% went to St. Charles County, and about 12% was actually in the city. And so we can see what the census shows and what new data is showing is that the growth is going to be in the suburbs. St. Charles is going to continue to experience exponential growth. It's not going to surpass, the population in St. Charles County is actually now larger than the population in the city of St. Louis, the Latino population. And so that trend is going to continue to happen. So what we're able to do, and I'm going to spend just a couple more minutes, I promise, is we built the database to look at block level with the census. We're able to go down to the block. And so now we have this for the entire region. And it takes several hours to really analyze this because it's block by block level. But this gives you a sense, because a lot of the maps we see will be at the county level and maybe at the census tract level. But what I'm really interested in is trying to find the natural patterns using block by block data of Latino clusters. And so we just started this analysis. To really do this, the next set of data is going to be released here in the next week or so, which will allow us to decompose the Latino category. And we'll be able to see where are the Mexicans living, where are the Puerto Ricans living, where are the Cubans living. And so that data is going to be coming here pretty soon. So this is what I call the number one block in the St. Louis metropolitan region. This is where this has the largest Latino population in the St. Louis metropolitan region in the Missouri side. And it's actually about 2 kilometers northwest of the museum. It's just right here in Skinker and Page. And so I think a lot of people would be shocked that that's actually got the largest absolute concentration of Latinos in the region, because I think a lot of people would think it'd be South St. Louis or maybe even north. So that's number one. The second largest block that has the absolute largest Latino population is actually in Town and Country. And those from the St. Louis region would probably be shocked that it's actually Town and Country that has the second largest Latino population at the block level. And so that's number two. And if you go back to we are making this map available. It's going to be online, it'll be interactive. And you can actually go in and zoom to each block. But you can kind of see there's a bunch of little red blocks there. So you can see in St. Charles, we're seeing more clustering happening in St. Charles, especially the city, compared to when we get out to St. Louis County and Jefferson County. So that's my 8 minutes. I'm happy to talk with you, share this data. It's online, it's an interactive forum, and I look forward to our discussion with our panelists.
Thank you, Ness. That was a great setup. I can't wait for that interactive map. Okay, so you've met me, you've met Ness. I want to introduce the remaining panelists with us. We have Julia Lopez. She is a PhD. Dr. Lopez is the instructor in medicine, Division of Infectious Diseases at Washington University School of Medicine. So I'm sure she's just been a teeny bit busy lately. We have Maria Rosario, Director of Strategic Communication and Enrollment Management at Ponce Health Sciences University. And Miguel Valerio, is also a PhD, assistant professor of Spanish at Washington University. I'm going to join everybody over here. And
okay, so I think we all have our mics. So I just want to start by asking our audience members, who knows when Hispanic Heritage Month began? And if you raise your hand, you have to say the year. Ding, ding, ding. Very good. Yes. In 1968, it actually started as a week, and it was introduced by a California Congressman, George Brown, who represented East Los Angeles, had a very large Hispanic community population then. And in so it was President Lyndon B. Johnson that declared Hispanic Heritage Week on the week of September 17th. And then there was a movement to turn it into a month. And that came from another California representative, Esteban Torres. He suggested it, but the bill did not pass. And then later on, Illinois Senator Paul Simon introduced a bill that did pass. And that was signed into law by President Ronald Reagan. And it was actually President George H.W. Bush that first declared National Hispanic Heritage Month. And so the date, it always starts on September 15th and it goes through October 15th. And the start date is actually the anniversary of the independence of several countries, Costa Rica, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, and Nicaragua. And Mexico and Chile's independence days are September 16th and 18th. So the month really incorporates all of those independence days, which are big celebrations. Each country has their own celebration to honor their independence. And so the month is, as we know, starting with an event like today, is really chock full of a lot of highlights of you know, music and dance and culture and important discussions about the Latinx identity. And so with that, I want to ask each of our panelists to just give a little background on where you're from. How did you arrive in St. Louis? Tell me what your Latinx, Latino, Hispanic identity means to you. Miguel.
Is this working? Yes. I'm originally, I was born in the Dominican Republic. Then when I was 10, I migrated to the US Virgin Islands. Then I went to college in New York. Then I did my PhD at Ohio State. And then I got a job as a professor in St. Louis. So there you have my itinerary for the last few decades. Part of that journey, a part of being an immigrant, has also have been a journey of coming to understand an identity, but also give myself an identity, right? Growing up in the Dominican Republic, we were the dominant group. If you know anything about the Dominican Republic, there are Dominicans and Haitians on the same islands, and let's say the Dominican government, state, country ideology is not very friendly towards the Haitian. But I was, you know, because I was part of the dominant group, I wasn't a victim. But then as an immigrant, I was right away signaled out. In the US, you have the phrase wetback. But in the island that I went, they call you santo. And it meant the same thing. And it just meant that you were undocumented with all the negative connotations that is meant to connote, right? And that was my first experience of being other, right? Being in a world where I am like those people in that video that we saw, right? I felt unwelcome in a strange place. I didn't know any English, and English was the language of the place. And then going on that journey, especially my PhD program I came to understand the many components that are part of my identity, right? So now I say that I'm Afro-Latinx, I'm Afro-Caribbean, Afro-Dominican, and I have all these multiple identities that form part of my identity, these complex things that I am.
Excellent, thank you. I just learned something new about it. Okay,
Maria. She's not a saint.
Exactly.
All right, so please let me know if you can't hear me at any time, because I'm kind of soft-spoken and then the mask really doesn't help. And if I start talking very fast, also let me know, because that typically happens when I'm presenting. Okay, so my name is Maria. My story is, you know, like Miguel, I've been to different places. So in my case, I was actually born in the US, in Western New York. And at about the age of 11 or 12, I actually moved to Puerto Rico. Moving to Puerto Rico was very interesting because basically my classmates and people in the community wouldn't accept me quickly. I would always be called gringa, you know, pretty much like, you're not from here. So it took me a while to, you know, kind of embrace being Puerto Rican in Puerto Rico, not being born in Puerto Rico, being told, you're not Puerto Rican, you weren't born here. You're American, you're not from here. So, you know, it was an experience that kind of took me some time to kind of analyze and appreciate. Then when I actually moved here to St. Louis in 2018, I've been here for about 2 years. I actually came here because of my job. So I actually work for Bonsa Health Sciences University. We opened a satellite campus here in St. Louis, and I was offered the opportunity to come here and expand the campus, expand our mission. And when I arrived here, you know, I kind of had the same experience I had when I moved to Puerto Rico. Like, oh, you're not American. Are you American? Is the U.S., is Puerto Rico considered, you know, Americans? And then you have to, like, go and start explaining to people, like, we're U.S. territory. We're born with U.S. citizenship. And you have to go down that rabbit hole of what that means and what that implies. Stay tuned to October that we have that panel where we'll go in depth about that. Please come to that specific activity. And, you know, also being confused with other races, with other backgrounds. I've been asked on multiple occasions, are you mixed? What are you mixed with? Are you white? Are you Black? Are you Mexican? I'm like, no, I'm Puerto Rican. So, you know, it's been a long journey and learning all of these things. Honestly, out of the three places I've lived, New York, Puerto Rico, St. Louis has actually been one of the places where I've felt more accepted because I've been able to communicate, be able to interact with people from different cultures, different backgrounds, and be able to share stories, and hear other people who have pretty much gone through the same thing or something very similar to what you've been through. And at the end of the day, you know, after years of contemplating and, you know, studying and researching myself and everything around me, I finally identify as Afro-Latinx, Afro-Caribeña, and Puerto Rican. I don't care where I'm born. At the end of the day, I'm Puerto Rican.
Thank you. Yep.
Awesome. Well,
Julia.
Yeah, I'm Julia here. So yeah, I, as my mom would say, was strategically born in Houston. And then I lived in Venezuela, in Barcelona. Yes, there is a Barcelona that is not in Spain. Barcelona, Venezuela. And so that's on the more of the kind of playa, the beach side of things in Venezuela. And so I lived there until I was nearly 7 years old. And then from there, I came back to the States and went to school and lived in different places, California, Arizona, Florida, Texas, those different spaces. So I moved around a lot. My dad was from Mexico and my mom is from Venezuela. And so being in Venezuela was really one of the kind of critical moments for a part of my identity. Not because Mexico wasn't, it's just that my father died when I was young. And so it was really hard for me to be able to kind of really identify in this strong way. And all of my family, which is very large on both sides, all of them migrated out of Mexico into like Texas, Arizona, New Mexico area. So it's been kind of like, for me, I have a very strong identity and I have a very strong understanding culturally of Venezuela, and I have less so for my Mexican like side of heritage. And I've struggled a long time with that because I felt like I wasn't doing my family or my people justice in that way. And then I've come to realize that I can, you know, that there's not like, I've not run out of time, right? That I can still like do the things that I want to do and still learn from that space. And so I've really taken into that and really trying to kind of delve deeper and talking more and thinking more about how do I do that in a bigger space. I think the other thing that's really hard for me is that my family in Venezuela, all of them live in Venezuela. So like my mom's the only one here, one of eight children. So like it's also very hard because like I say I live here, but I don't really think of the US as my home. So my home is like where my abuela's house is that I can like see in my head in Venezuela. So, you know, I like, obviously being in the US has afforded me many opportunities and I feel very privileged, of course. And in that I've been able to support my family in many ways, but it is a very big part of the story that I have about how I talk about myself and how I talk about my identity. A big other part of like being able to realize like who I am in that space is also being a queer individual and really realizing like how that can be difficult in the Latin culture. And so being really scared to tell my family that I'm gay, you know, and that my family, you know, having a hard time reconciling that, especially feeling that, like, how was growing up here in the latter parts of my life influential potentially in that space, but trying to explain to them that it's not a choice, you know, that I've always been who I have always been. And so I think, you know, that's another big part of like my identity as like not only a Latina, but also as like a queer Latina, and really understanding like how do I fit into these spaces, and really feeling like that's an important space that I like to bring to St. Louis, because St. Louis, I've been here for a number of years. I came for school and I just kept going to school over and over again. And then, so then I, you know, I just kept going to school and then I started working. And as was mentioned, I work at WashU at the School of Medicine. So like, you know, just being involved in that work and working in communities was really important. And so being able to do some of that work has been really fulfilling. So it's been one of those things where I feel very strongly about like my identity and I feel very good about where I'm at. It's been a struggle for sure being able to get there, but I wouldn't take back any of the experiences I've had thus far to get to where I'm at.
Thank you, Julia. Ness.
I was born in Denver, Colorado. At the age of three, we moved with my mom's family back to Nebraska in a small town called Scotts Bluff. And so my dad's family is actually from New Mexico, and they became US citizens in 1848 during the Mexican-American War. And so we pick them up in the census in 1850, but they were living in Taos, New Mexico for many, many, many decades before the war began. And so they became US citizens because of the war. So they have a very different identity compared to my mom's family. They left Mexico during the Mexican Revolution, and my grandpa and grandmother met in New Mexico, and then they made their way through Kansas. But her brother got to Nebraska in 1920. And so her goal was to come and live with her brother. And part of what happened was at that time they were rebuilding their railroads to Nebraska. And so they were picking names out of a hat, and they picked a name of Jose Ramirez, and Jose Ramirez never answered. And so my grandfather, my mom's dad, said, "I'm Jose Ramirez." And so that, and they already had, I think they had seven kids already by that time, Gonzalez. And one of them, they were very old. They were like 14 already. And so he came home and said, we're going to Nebraska to the town where her brother lived, but we have to change our name to Ramirez. And this has been a point of controversy in my family, because the older kids felt that they should not have to change their name. And they blamed the young kids, like my mom was the second youngest. They had to give up their identity for the three youngest kids who were born in Nebraska. And so what happened is a short story. So the oldest aunt had, because my grandparents didn't speak English, she ran and enrolled the younger kids in school and she changed their first name. So that, well, if you have to change our last name, you don't get to have your first name. And so they all got English names and she enrolled them and they took away their Spanish first names. So it's kind of an interesting story. So we grew up with those kind of stories. And my hometown was 30% Mexican when I was growing up. We grew up during the Chicano movement. And so as a very young kid, 5 years old, it was very normal to say I'm Chicano because that was the 1970s, 72, 73. That was the label that was used in my, that was how you identified yourself as I'm Chicano. And so that's my biography.
Thank you. So a little bit more about my background. So my parents are both from Colombia, South America, and they came here 50 plus years ago. My dad came to practice medicine and, you know, they just, it was a typical immigrant story, right? They didn't know the language. They didn't know anyone. They arrived in Chattanooga, Tennessee at 4 a.m. after having taken a bus from Miami. And my dad had an interview the next morning and he and my mom could not communicate with the hotel staff. They could not understand them. He was looking for an iron to iron his tie for the interview. And so he had to put the tie under his mattress. And so, you know, he somehow, you know, he got the job and he was working at the hospital there. And they were fortunate that one of the first nurses that they met happened to be from Bogota, Colombia. She became their ally. She became their angel. My parents, you know, my dad was working all day. My mom was home, pregnant with me, with my sister, didn't know the language. It was very, very, very difficult. They wanted to go back, but they, you know, just the classic, right? They sacrificed to stay here. And my siblings and I were born in Chattanooga, Tennessee, but we were really raised primarily in Wisconsin, small town in Wisconsin. And, you know, so I grew up and I don't typically look, you know, Hispanic. So when I grew up, I'm a little embarrassed to say I had a little bit of shame. My parents had thick accents. We would go to the grocery store and my mom would speak to us in Spanish. And I just wanted to blend in. You know, I had friends who made fun of my parents' accents. And so I really struggled for a long time of like, what am I and where do I fit in? You know, it's interesting. My work has really brought me back to my roots, which I just absolutely love to be in a role to help families, maybe like my parents or, you know, business people that come here and they can't speak the language. And so it's very personal to me. But in terms of my identity, it's, you know, I've traveled quite a bit to Colombia and like Julia, most of my family is there or many of them are also in Miami. But when I go to Colombia, my cousins say, oh, you know, típica americana, right? Like I'm not Colombian enough. And here it's always, well, what are you? That's always been the question of what are you? In the summer, I used to get very, very tan, you know, pre-SPF days. But and people would ask me if I was mulatto. They didn't know, are you Hawaiian? Are you Asian? I've always been like, it's just been uncomfortable for me until, you know, the last several years. So, you know, that's my story. I mean, I love being bicultural. I love the fact that we can travel to other countries and really, you know, fit in two different places. And so, but you know, it's always the progression, I guess, of our identity. And so, I love that you said, Maria, that of all the places you've lived, you feel most welcome in St. Louis. I love that, right? Because that's what we're talking about is being welcoming. So that's certainly music to Mosaic's ears. And so let's just talk about, and we've sort of touched on it a little bit here, but the biggest misperception about, you know, this term Latinidad, the identity, you know, Hispanic versus Latino versus Latinx, Chicano, you know, Ness, you mentioned that. So whoever wants to just jump in and tackle that question, but, you know, just talk about the label and what do you think of it? How do you correct a person, or how do you, you know, what's your preference in being, how you are identified?
I'll just start with a caveat because I'm a demographer. So what we get from the census are the labels that they use, right? This is the labels that are used by the executive branch. We have access to what people actually write. And so it's really, it's fascinating to see the time that people put in terms of identifying who they are. And so we don't really see that story. We just see the story that, well, this person marked that they were Latino and they're Black and so forth. And that's what gets on the New York Times, right? But we can actually go see the detailed information, and it's fascinating. So we do a lot of work on using birth certificates. And it's very clear, like when people put tremendous amount of time in saying, this is how I want my child, because that's an official document, right? That birth certificate is an official document. And so you can see what those labels are. And I can tell you, it's not just one category. We get that they're Hispanic or Latino. It's a very complicated, nuanced identity that's being put there. So I'll leave it at that comment, because there is no consistency. I'll just give you one example. So I always ask the question, are Brazilians considered Latino or Hispanic? And I said, it depends. If we use the executive branch definition, no. If we use the congressional branch definition, yes. And not only are Brazilians Latino, but if you're of Portuguese descent, you're Latino, according to the congressional branch. And so I think a lot of people are surprised. I didn't realize that you don't have to be from Brazil, you can be from Portugal, and you're classified as Latino in the congressional definition. So we don't have any consistency, even at the federal level, of how people get counted. And so there was supposed to be some clarity in 2020, but that for a variety of reasons didn't happen. We're gonna have another opportunity in 2030 to try to get some consistency with the terminology. I'm not sure what's gonna happen, because a lot of this is politics. Mm-hmm. But beyond that, if we're able to actually see the stories that people are telling, the story of this is Latino, Hispanic, it's really kind of misleading, because people are telling that they have very complicated identities. We don't see that.
Yeah, I just because in the 2020, were people allowed to write in?
Yes, they were.
Because I remember I worked in the 2010 census,
yeah,
and people were allowed to write in.
Yeah.
And I remember that the people from Latin America or Hispanic that I got to interview, they would put their country, the nationality rather than their identity. But just to give an answer, my answer to this question, what Ness is showing is, we have the official numbers, or the government, the official labels. And because coming into contact with labels, I guess, has been part of my immigrant experience, as it is of so many of us, right? But also the journey of self-understanding. And when you put those together, right, you have external labels, government labels, and the labels that your neighbors give you. But as I said before, I am Afro-Latino, which means I have Latin American origin and I live in the US. I'm Afro-Caribbean, I'm from the Caribbean, and I have African blood, and Afro-Dominican, because I'm Dominican, but I have African blood, right? And so my identity is a nexus of many things. And there is a lot of debate, especially you can call intellectual circles, about the label Latinx. There is a group that accepts it, and I'm part of the group that accepts it when it is understood as a label that is meant to be as inclusive as possible. But I have no problem with people who don't want to use it because they don't like it, and that's fine. It's your identity, and you don't have to like the label. You can label yourself, which is part of the write-in, right? Label yourself as you see yourself, as you understand yourself. So,
yeah, I think when we think about Latinx, which is very much US-centric, right? So if I were to say Latinx to my family in Venezuela on WhatsApp, they'd be like, ¿qué? ¿Qué estás diciendo? Like, vente para acá. Like, too much time in the U.S. Like, and so, you know, the Latinx piece is really meant to be inclusive of sexual and gender minority folks. So we're talking about people who may not identify as, you know, a person who is like, I identify as a woman, a cisgender woman. So I was born female, and I also think of myself as a woman, right? And so I use, my pronouns are she, ella, right? But there are people who were born with, you know, let's say they were born with female organs, but, you know, as time passes, they realize that that's not truly who they are. And then they transition, or something changes. And so they, you know, transition to being in a different space for their own gender identity. And they may transition in the space where they're a transgender, you know, person. So they've transitioned their sex, right? Sex at birth versus what their gender identity is now. And some people don't do that fully, right? They're in this, what we call non-binary space. So a space where they neither identify as a man or a woman, right? And so Latinx, the X is meant to really be inclusive of that larger group of people, right? That we're really not thinking not just of man and woman as just this like very like gray, you know, this black and white space, but that there are people all in the in-between, and that gender and gender specifically is a spectrum and it's fluid. And so that can be really hard kind of conversation to have with people depending on who you're talking with or what's happening. I know I've had multiple conversations with persons in my family to trying to understand that space. And then also I work specifically in mental health. And so a lot of the people I see are people who are questioning their gender, right? Really questioning, you know, I was born, you know, a girl, but I don't feel that that is who I am, you know, and really questioning that and not feeling that they have a space to talk about that. And they're Latin, right? And, you know, they don't have a lot of family around. And so they don't have a lot of support and they need some of that additional support. And come to me because I'm a therapist, you know, to be able to kind of help kind of guide and understand like where they are in that kind of space. And that is what Latinx is really supposed to be about, really trying to be inclusive of not just, you know, Latinas and Latinos, but that there are people in the in-between. And that is like an appropriate space that we need to be thinking about for people. And so that can be really hard to translate, I think, when we're talking, like, especially for me, when I'm talking to my family, because that's not a language that's like a part of like the Spanish language. And so we've seen kind of why some people feel very strongly about not using that label. And as Miguel said, I would agree, like, if that's not like how you identify, then you don't need to use it. But like for me, I do, because I work with people who are sexual and gender minority folks. So as a queer woman, I also work with people who are coming from sexual minority, you know, spaces. So they really need support in this other kind of way that they don't often get in other spaces. So I'm going to be really using that language because that feels really comfortable and comforting to the people who are seeking services from me. And that's what they need, because not only have they been, you know, discriminated against because of their race or ethnicity, but because of also their sexuality or gender. And so there's a lot of things that are happening all at the same time, and people are very alone. You put then on top of that a pandemic, and it becomes exponentially harder. So I feel very strongly about using Latinx, but I totally understand, like, from my family space or from my other friends' spaces, why they feel more, you know, that they feel more closely aligned to using a different label or using an even more specific kind of label for them. I think labels can be really helpful, and sometimes they can be really damaging, right? It's kind of like a toss-up sometimes. I think it can be helpful, and then other times it can be really hurtful and painful for people, depending on how they're used. Either they're used for you or they're used against you, and I've seen that happen a lot.
Sorry, I guess it's my turn.
Yeah.
So basically, in my personal life, just like my colleagues, I also use Latinx. However, for work, you know, I work for a university, so we have to use Latino, Latina. Sadly, the government and all the official people still use that terminology. But I do just want to give some pointers on why some people don't necessarily like using those types of labels. And it's because it's just that. It's a label. There's people that feel that it's a way for the government to just jumble all of these people from different backgrounds into one category, and kind of also whitewashing the fact that, you know, we have our African raices, our indigenous raices, and just like try to put an easy label to just categorize everyone and not really go into depth. And like Miguel was saying, he identifies as Afro-Latina because, you know, Latin America, Caribeña because he's from the Caribbean, and then Dominican because he's from the Dominican Republic. It's more complicated. It's not just simple, and that's why some people don't necessarily like the concept, because they're like, no, you're just trying to push us all into one category and not really taking into consideration everything else that it actually includes.
All labels are by nature reductive, but a necessary evil.
Yep.
Right.
One final comment. I think the point about the US context is very important, because when we look at when people actually write, you will see that they'll mark, because the way we do it now, we have it ethnicity and race. So we'll have many people mark that they are not Hispanic, Latino, and then they'll write in, I'm Puerto Rican or I'm Mexican. And it's like, because they probably don't understand what Hispanic, Latino means, because it's got a US context. And we see this all the time in the census, but we also see it with the birth and death certificates. Like they're not his, but then they'll be very specific, and they'll put it in Spanish. Like this is my identity, but they'll mark I'm not Hispanic. So there is this, that these contexts have a different currency in the United States compared to if you were living in Germany or something like that. It has a different currency there, right?
Yeah, that definitely makes a lot of sense, because I feel like when I fill out the census, I put that and I write in Venezuelan and Mexican. Right, so like I always write in. Or there was always the issue with race and ethnicity weren't together, mm-hmm. and they were separate. So you had to pick a race, but it was right. Like, I'm not white, but I'm also none of these other things. So I just always left that blank. But it was like, I'm not this, I'm over here, right? And so that was always really confusing. I think it's very US centric, because if you talk to other people from other countries, it's a very specific phenomenon that happens here, that it's like a very specific space that happens in the US. And I think that it's really kind of interesting to kind of see like how people, like when I meet people randomly or when I'm meeting people who want to come see me for services, they'll be like, where are you from? That's the first thing, because they hear my accent. And so they'll be like, they'll think that first either I'm from They'll either think I'm from Puerto Rico, because I, or they'll be, or they'll think that I'm from like Colombia. So like, and I'm like, oh, you're close, but you know, next door. But you know, but people are always interested, and they're like, ah, Venezolana, you know, and then they'll talk about this or that, and they're like, oh, I'm from, and then they'll talk about this and the other thing, and so people, although we realize like that we are all from different spaces, it feels nice to know that, like, even though like my culture looks and is different than like Mexican culture, that it is nice to feel that you're in a space that people can have a general idea of what you're feeling or understanding, or that you can have a shared experience, even though you know that it's not going to be exactly the same, and that we have different foods and different accents in different dialects and all of those things. And I think that that's really, that's what makes it so interesting and so beautiful. And I think, unfortunately, we do get very much like put into this big box that's just like all the Latin people. I'm like, that is very not okay.
If I may make a final point about this and the discussion that is going on about Latinx and identity, is another thing that is going on now is that Haitians want to be considered in the category. And I remember when I was a graduate student, we had to teach Latin America. And I had a conversation with another student, and we were comparing syllabus as we always do. And he wasn't going to include Haiti in the syllabus. I'm like, well, Haiti is part of Latin America, right? And from that premise that because Latin America means country that speak languages that come from Latin, right? So Haiti speaks French, and the other countries that speak French in the Caribbean, and then you have Brazil. And so a lot of young Haitians I have seen this going in blogs, writing, you know, how they are also part of the Latinx community, especially with this conversation that we're having around Afro-Latinx identity, right? As a big component of that population.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So for me, I know whenever I identify, I like to specify Colombian, or that I'm from Colombia, or my parents are from Colombia, but in Missouri, I have to say South America, because people always think it's Colombia, Missouri. Just kind of a bummer. literally.
Not Barcelona, Wisconsin.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Barcelona, Spain. No.
No, but I was going to ask to expand on the Afro-Latinx identity. And I'm just wondering about the notion of, you know, Maria and Miguel, who you both identify as Afro-Latino. So do you ever get pushback from that? Do you ever have people in the Black community saying you're not Black enough?
The people that I hang around with, nah, I don't get pushback, but me.
Sure.
In academia, admittedly, we are in somewhat of a bubble. It's a conversation that is taking place, as I say, in intellectual circles. But there is also a parallel with this in Latin America. So first, the conversation began in universities in the US, and then it went mainstream with Amara La Negra and other people who were appearing on Telemundo and Univision, who began identifying as Afro-Latinx. I don't watch too much Telemundo Univision, but I know there was a beauty queen who identified as Afro-Latinx, and she was like the first beauty queen in such a contest that are always on Telemundo Univision who identify as Afro-Latinx, and that was a big deal. Mm-hmm. And the connection to Latin America is that for the last 20 years, people of African descent in Latin America have been fighting to have a category in the census. And so now a lot of the countries have this category, and it was through Black activism. So Black activism is big in Latin America. And there's also the connection of Black activism in the US. So there was this triangle between civil rights, the legacy, Black lives in Latin America, and then the problem of colorism and racism in the Latinx community, which is a big problem for people who, for example, the way I was raised in the Dominican Republic, I can go around saying I'm white, but I'm not white, right? But that's how Dominican racial language works. But then there are people who are just Black and they cannot go around saying, right? And for those people, right, they realize, well, I'm Afro-Latinx, right? Mm-hmm. I have these two identities. And that began that conversation. And in the last 3 years, Mexico passed a constitutional amendment So Mexico had this in the constitution. It named two national groups, indigenous and mestizos, right? Those were the two only national groups, which meant in this country there were only indigenous and mestizos. And then 2 years ago, they amended the constitution to recognize Afro-Mexicans as the third national group. Chile did the same thing, and Colombia and Argentina had done something else. So there's a hemispheric movement. And we saw this come into the fore with George Floyd, because there were huge marches in Latin America. And the phrase in Portuguese, as vidas negras importan, and las vidas negras importan, were being used in social media. And there were big marches in Colombia, in Argentina, and everywhere in Brazil, and which Brazil has a parallel problem with race and policing, very parallel to the US, or even worse, because Brazil has two types of police. They have a civil police and they have a military police. And every time there is trouble in the favelas in Rio, they call the military police, which just goes in and opens fire on people, and there is no, So this is a broad, large conversation going on about coming to term with the Black part of Latin identity.
Yeah, no, so Miguel did a good job as a historian giving a lot of the historical details, so thank you for that. But you did mention something towards the end, which I just forgot, but that's okay, because I'm gonna keep talking. So pretty much what I would like to just kind of put my two cents is, you can see the difference of growing up now in Puerto Rico and growing up in Puerto Rico back in the day. I remember I had grandparents, uncles, aunts that would be like, don't go out with that boy. You have to make sure you stay as white as possible. I don't know if anybody in the audience who's from Puerto Rican descent remembers when those conversations used to happen. And it's a very big issue and big conflict in Puerto Rico. It's still a struggle that's going on. In the past couple of years, I'd say since the Black Lives Matter movement started, like Miguel said, other countries also started adopting it and also supporting. And you've seen over the last couple of years, people accepting more their identity, their Black heritage. Back in the day, I was a victim of this. I didn't want curly hair. I wanted straight hair because that was what was acceptable. Curly, unruly hair, that was a no.
Yeah, we both have bad hair. And we're proud.
Yo, no, and my hair actually looks like that naturally. I just, put some product in it. But back in the day, you couldn't have curly hair. Nowadays, you're seeing more women wearing their hair natural. The bigger the fro, the better. You also see people wearing now in Puerto Rico head wraps. That used to not really be a thing. It used to be a thing back in the day when we used to have slaves and whatnot, but you wouldn't see that as part of a fashion statement. Nowadays, you see women wearing head wraps all the time because it's fashionable, because they're accepting who they are, and they're proud of having that African heritage. But yes, definitely, there's a lot of colorism in the Latinx community. It's something that has improved in the past couple of years, but a perfect example of that is right now in the Olympics, when Jasmine Camacho won the gold medal for Puerto Rico. There were people that were like, she's not Puerto Rican. She wasn't born here, which I go back to what I said at the beginning. She wasn't born here. She's Black. She's not Puerto Rican. And that was a big issue, and that was a big controversy. And then you'd see all of these debates on the internet of people saying, yes, she is, no, she's not, yes, she is, no, she's not. So it's something that's still happening. There have been improvements, but it's something that we still need to work on.
I just add a little bit, sorry. No, just to add that two of the best Black writers in Spanish right now are Puerto Rican, Yolanda Arroyo Pizarro and Santos Febre, Miriam Santos Febre, the from Puerto Rico, and the two of the best that I teach, Black writers in from Latin America.
I was going to say, Maria, can you explain colorism? just for clarity.
Okay, sake. Wait, we have 20 minutes.
I mean, you know, what are we good? You mentioned it, and so I just thought it'd be good for the sake of.
For sure.
Oh, my hand is over to the professor.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's I mean, I, my family, which was the gamma of colors, if you will. Of course, everybody has a white grandfather with blue eyes, blah, blah, blah. I mean, we did have cousins who were born blonde with blue eyes. So I don't know how that happened, but anyway. But that's colorism, that gamma, right? But comparison, right? And then one sociologist, he calls it pigmentocracy, right? Privilege is attached to how close you are to whiteness, right? So it's discrimination based on how dark you are. And the darker you are, the least access to privilege you get, right? So that from white is La Gloria, and then white passing and stuff like that. And then once you get beyond a certain point, negro, right? You know, no privilege, but yeah, this happens in the community, in the Latinx community. It happens in the home context and the community at large. And if you have been watching Telemundo or Univision over the years, right, it's only recently that they have Black anchors and Black people on the forefront of Telemundo, where before Hispanic television meant the one who looked like Miss Venezuela, right? Stuff like that. And you know what it means to look like Miss Venezuela.
Yeah, I just feel like it's really important to talk about colorism because in my family, it's like we have such an interesting mix of people, and even when we would go out together, like how I would be impacted versus how my cousins would be impacted, because you know my aunt is Afro-Latina. And so then, you know, that kind of mixture, and then like just kind of seeing how all of that was, and even within my family, how everybody would talk to each other, and like in the way that they would bring up the color of a person's skin, like as being a part of that. And I think that that's really important because there's still like that impact very much so within our own culture and within our own family, especially if we have family that is like mixed, right? In whatever capacity, may it be through, you know, marriage or otherwise.
Yeah, good conversation. I wanted to open it up to the to our audience and ask you if you have any comments. It doesn't have to be a question, but anything you want to share, anything you've heard that resonates, or anything you want to challenge that you might have heard. Yes. I was wondering.
What was the question?
Yeah, you're saying from the government's classification, is that what you mean? Oh, us, yeah. So the question
can
is,
can I give the history of the term? Yeah. So yes, the term Latinx began at Princeton.
Princeton?
It was a group of graduate students. So we have gone through many phrases in terms of our community, our government labels, right? Chicano was, and it still is for many people of Afro-Mexican descent, right? And then the government came up with Hispanic, but then some people didn't like it, so we came up with Latino, right? And then we had Latino, but the problem of language, as Julia was signaling earlier, Spanish is like the Romance languages, is a gender language. So that words, especially nouns, either masculine or feminine, right? And this group of students in conversation at Princeton, they realized that these terms were gender exclusive, right? had been tried before. What was tried before was Latino with the at sign, like in your email. So Latino with the at sign. That was tried. That was the first attempt, and that is still used by some people. And then this group, they came up with Latinx, which kind of harking a little bit back to Malcolm X and what a lot of people did in the Nation of Islam, was get rid of their name, and then the X is an open thing, right? And what something that Julio was saying, that this doesn't work in Latin America because the X is not accepted. So what they do in Latin America is they use Latine with an E. But there is a conversation about inclusive language going on also in Latin America and Spain, right? Well, Latinx is not being used, but Latine is being used instead of Latinx. And then Latinx has become mainstream in the last 5 years, I would say. As again, coming from institution below and people getting into the media, and then queer people getting into the media and social media and propagating the term. And so now it can be used as a universal umbrella of inclusivity. And that's its best intention, right? Which doesn't bar debate.
Yeah, and I think that in some of the spaces that I follow, like large national spaces that are for like Latin health, right? Or that are really specific to like social justice issues or things like that. I've noticed, because today is like the start of the Heritage Month, I noticed specifically, I got like these emails and newsletters of like the beginning of the month that specifically had Latinx Heritage Month instead. I don't know if anybody else noticed that, or if they got any newsletters that kind of noticed that. And I was like, oh, interesting. I mean, I was excited, but yeah. I was like, oh, this is interesting, because they were large. There are large bodies of organizations that talk in or have like big crowds that they're like sourcing out to about various things. Obviously, I'm getting a lot of things about health and health oriented stuff. So that's like my focus, but I would be interested to know like if like business oriented stuff or entrepreneurial stuff or, you know, just other sectors of work are also seeing kind of a shift as well. I would say that I can't imagine that there won't be like this grander shift, you know, because I think that it just is trending that way anyway.
Well, I think it's many years before it makes it to the census.
Right.
Oh, sure.
50 or some.
What do you think, Ness?
Yeah.
And it's also going to vary by the region of the US you're mm-hmm. in. So I agree. Mm-hmm. So the census that's years of study about these about the terms used and how people self-identify. And so I would guess, for example, if you went to Miami and used that term Latinx, you're going to get a lot of people not using it, because the term Latino is not even accepted in Miami. It's Hispanic. And we know this from the census experiment of the sensitivity of Latino and Hispanic in different cities. And so, yeah, you have a lot of people who are, will say they're Cuban, but they will not say that they're Latino, they're Hispanic. And so there's a sensitivity in terms of, the question is how do you get people to do it? Do you have the pre-made boxes, or do you have an open end and say, what's your identity? And so that's always been the challenge, because when you say, what's your identity? You get the authentic responses of saying, this is how I self-identify. But when you have the pre-selected check mark and saying, okay, are you Mexican, Cuban, Puerto Rican? Then many people, they look and check really fast. But we know that there's sensitivity and difference. So in Orlando would be another city, right? Orlando's the largest city of Puerto Ricans. It's very sensitive, like in terms of the term you're gonna use there in Orlando versus Los Angeles or Houston. And so I think in popular culture, Latinx is gonna be used. When it comes to government government definitions, I think we need to, there's just to be an element, like if you change the term, you may see a decline in the number of people who self-identify as Latinx, simply because they may see it as a different identity. It has to do with Latino, not Hispanic, not Latino. But we know that the census did have these results saying you have to be careful with the terminology you use because it's gonna vary by city. And that's why they were very clear in the 2020 census of making sure that specific terms were in and out in the description. And there's a whole debate of why did so many people say that they're not white anymore? Was it because they got rid of the term white and they put in, are you English, French, German? Or you look at the increase in the number of Native Americans. Well, they added the term Aztec and Mayan in the definition, right? Some other terms that were used for the first time. And so like, did more people say they're Native American because they identify being Aztec? We're gonna get that data here in a couple of weeks. And so we'll have a better sense of what happened. But there's an element there that there's a lot of variation by region of the country.
Okay, we do have some questions I wanna get to from our Zoom viewers, I think, or maybe the audience. But the first question I was handed says, what will attract Latinos in Texas and California to move to St. Louis? And what is the messaging? And I think that's, you know, complicated. I think about, I have a younger cousin who lives in Miami and he's been there, you know, for a decade or so. And he would like to move away from Miami. You know, he says there are too many Latinos there. I don't know if it's a matter of, I mean, I think the general things that have anybody attracted to an area, cost of living is good.
Job opportunities.
Correct, job opportunities. And that it is a
restaurant options.
Yep. That it is a welcoming community. I don't know how you all feel.
So I'll just give an interesting factoid. So there will be more Mexicans leaving California than moving to other US cities than Mexicans coming from Mexico. That's just a demographic fact. And so so the question that becomes, okay, which cities are they, well, we kind of know where they're going now, right? Denver, Salt Lake City, but they're not coming to St. Louis.
Right,
So the question is I think that there's a perception, right or wrong, that St. Louis is in Missouri. And Missouri has a bigger perception of you're not welcome here.
Correct, right. Well, Missouri, but again, I think St. Louis, hopefully we're willing to, you know, we have been rolling out the welcome mat. I think a lot of it too depends on going where they know someone, at least. I mean, that's always the first step, I think, when you're going to somewhere new is, where do I know somebody that can help me?
Yeah.
You know, so I would say it's a combination of again, reinforcing that we are welcome to diverse cultures and then letting them know that there's a Latino population here.
But there has to be intention. So I'm just going to speak to my university. So my university tends to recruit in its traditional cities. I'm not saying it's bad, but they go back to Omaha, Nebraska, Kansas City, Indianapolis. But that's not where they should be recruiting. They need to go to Houston, Texas. They need to go to Dallas, Texas. They need to go to Phoenix, Arizona to recruit. But when you go to those cities, you're recruiting a different population.
Right.
Houston's gonna be a majority Mexican city. Texas, if it isn't, the largest population in Texas will be Latino here in the next 1 to 2 years. And it'll be a majority population very soon. And so you as institutions, if you're interested in diversity, you have to go to Texas, Arizona, Miami, to Florida, and be intentional. So we want these students here. I understand why it's easy to go to Omaha, Nebraska, right? It's very easy, but you're pulling a different population there. That's very similar to what you have been recruiting for the last 20, 30 years. But that's not, if you look at that, that's not the future population. The white non-Hispanic population in Missouri and St. Louis is not, it's in decline. And so if you if you meet new students, it's going to be Latinos and Asian Americans.
Yeah, no, I'd actually like to chime in right here. I can't go as granular as which city they come from, but currently the majority of the students who go to PHSU are actually coming from Texas and Florida. So like you're mentioning, you know, the next couple of years, how do we get more Latinx students here in St. Louis, recruiting in those specific cities where the Latinx population is pretty big, and making sure that they know that, hey, Missouri is an option for you. Because right now, you know, students in those areas are already aware that we exist and actually have interest in coming here. So it's just a matter of just, you know, making the message a lot stronger and getting even more people to,
right, know. Exactly. And I'm just curious, when you're in recruiting or you're talking to somebody who's considering the move up here, what is their perception of St. Louis?
I think you have to be honest.
I mean, again,
I think if you look at the national media and you objectively counted the number of national stories, not local stories, national stories about the city, almost all of them are negative.
Right.
And then I started comparing, like, how many negative stories have I seen about Denver, Colorado in the past year? It'd be hard, but people can come up with three easy stories in the past year that are negative about St. Louis. It's not even difficult for them.
Right.
Yeah.
There's a national narrative
the last story that I saw in the New York Times about St. Louis was positive, but it was because of the new mayor, right? But generally they are, right? Well, St. Louis has become the epicenter of the birthplace of the Black Lives Matter movement, and that's a good thing, right? When I was offered this job, I was glad I was coming to St. Louis and no other part of the state.
I have one more question I want to get to. We have about five more minutes, but so the comment is, I'm so tired being the only Latina at work, school, most social circles in St. Louis. How does one not burn out? I think that says burnout, especially raising Latino kids to be seen. You know, and I mean, it's hard to answer that not knowing the context of, you know, where does this person live and all of that. But I mean, I would say, and we're preaching to the choir here, but you know, there are a lot of things going on in the Hispanic community here in St. Louis. I mean, you know, Ness shared the demographics. I mean, we know there's a lot of Hispanic-owned businesses and restaurants in Cherokee and in St. Charles and, you know, wonderful restaurants all over. And we have professional organizations and organizations like the History Museum and a lot of the art organizations. And, you know, we were talking about Afro-Latino identity, and there's a wonderful mural that's being, I'm not sure if it's completed yet, but it celebrates that intersectionality of Afro-Latino down on in the Del Mar Divine. So right down there at Del Mar and Skinker. And so I would say, I mean, I don't know, you know, go on Facebook. There's every single group, Colombianos, Venezolanos, you know, Mexicanos in St. Louis, those groups on Facebook. Get involved with some of these organizations that we've mentioned. You know, and give your children the language to use to empower them to talk about the pride in their heritage. I know, you know, I'm married to a St. Louisan, and I have two boys who have so much orgullo to be Colombian, and they love it. And you know, it's that's been because, you know, they spend time with my parents. They've been to Colombia. We talk about it. We have music in Spanish. You know, it's, I don't know. I don't know how the person herself is talking about her own identity, but it's about conversations like we're having now.
Yeah, I mean, it can be difficult to feel and be in the situation, especially now with COVID, because before COVID, the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce and other organizations used to hold lots of events, and the Latino Festival hasn't been held, right? So those spaces that we have lost. So COVID has made the isolation even worse. And yeah, it's a tough place to be.
It is.
So seek out the community. They're on social media, they're mm-hmm. available.
And we have Red Latina, we have, yeah. I'm not sure if we have a radio program anymore, but anyway.
Yeah. I would like to just say that, you know, I think with obviously people in the audience and also people watching and on the panelists, like, but that's a very real feeling, of course, so I empathize with that wholeheartedly. Feeling alone in a lot of spaces, and then also being picked out to speak for like all of Latin America and all people, that also feels really not good. So it feels like you're being used, and that's not what I'm here for. And so it can be difficult to not feel tired about like looking for or doing something, because it's just like always a hurdle, and it's always feeling like you're just like walking through mud instead of walking, you know, on pavement. Like making things a little bit easier for oneself can be a lot harder than not, and so it's definitely difficult. And I don't have children, so I can only imagine like what that feels like. I know that I can only understand it through like the lens of like being a child, you know, an adult child, and my mom talking a lot to that space of like how she wanted me to feel very centered in my, like in who I was and how I am. But that was also like really a struggle, you know, when I would be like bullied or told nasty things, or, you know, or people would make fun of my mom because she has a really thick accent. And then I decided when I was younger that like I wasn't gonna have an accent. So, you know, I really worked to not. That's really messed up, you know, like, and that all is like really difficult space. So I think like finding community can be hard, but like even just like one or two people can make a big difference, I've found. And building that connection can be hard, especially if you have kids. Too. So it makes it even more difficult because you don't have the liberty to like have the same amount of free time as you would maybe otherwise. And so really trying to find that space is not easy, but hopefully in any one of these spaces, there are going to be many, many others who feel the same. And I only say that because I've spoken to many, many people because I've been doing therapy for, I can't remember, 15 years, something like that. Working with people in the community for a long time in St. Louis, from various Latin backgrounds. And so, and people have talked about a similar sentiment. And so I'm hearing the stories and hearing the struggle. And so I just want this person to know that like, you're most definitely not alone in that.
And I will just, you know, again, put a plug in for the Cuentos en Español that the History Museum hosts. I know this weekend there's Fiestas Cardenales at the St. Louis Cardinals. It's a ticketed event with music and festivities and, you know, a rousing Hispanic community of Cardinals fans. Día de los Muertos, yes. And I would just encourage everyone to check out www.welcomingweekstl.com. It's a boatload of events taking place between now and September 19th during Welcoming Week, which includes a lot of events for the Hispanic community and the overlap of Hispanic heritage and documentaries online and in person events. So I think we probably have one more minute.
Okay, before we finish, I'm gonna be bold and might get in trouble for this. Emily, could you help us get the person's contact information? If it's someone from Zoom, so that way we can send the person links to the different organizations here in St. Louis. And that way, you know, they can start trying to reach out and, find their own family here.
Yep, very good. Well, I want to thank my panelists, Ness, Julia, Maria, Miguel. It's been really great. I've enjoyed hearing from you more, getting to know you a little bit more, and having all of us just share our stories. And, you know, it helps us all belong a little bit more. So, and thank you so much
for the audience, the in-person audience and the Zoom audience. Gracias, and to Emily and the Missouri History Museum. Thank you so much. Okay.